knows a lot about the science stuff. Professor Dave explains.
Understanding the mechanisms of evolution is imperative for understanding how and why organisms change over time. Much of the basics regarding this topic have been covered in the Biology and Genetics playlist, linked below. So if this is completely new territory, that will be useful in getting up to speed, as much of that knowledge will be assumed in this series. In this tutorial, we will discuss the four primary mechanisms of evolution in relation to some specific examples in order to explain how large-scale changes to organisms can occur. Evolution is generally described quite simply as a change in the allelic frequency of a population across successive generations. It is the foundation of biology in that it ultimately explains all of the biodiversity we see today and throughout the distant past, leading back to a universal common ancestor. The subcategories of evolution, microevolution and macroevolution, respectively refer to changes within a species and speciation, or changes between species. We see both of these processes in the lab, in the wild, and in the geologic column. Examples of microevolution would include the various breeds of domestic dog, or Canis familiaris, the selective breeding of the wild mustard plant, Brassica oleracea, into numerous modern vegetables, and changes in the tusk size of African elephants, or Loxodonta africana. Examples of macroevolution include the speciation of Encetina salamanders in California, numerous lab experiments with Drosophila resulting in reproductive isolation, and classically Darwin's finches. The mechanisms that cause both macroevolution and microevolution impact primates and thus humans as well, making them critical to understanding biological anthropology. Mutation, the first mechanism, is the raw material for evolution. Novel genetic changes allow natural selection to act in new ways on an organism. If the mutation increases fitness for an individual and creates differential reproductive success within a population, it may be selected for and lead to that mutation becoming fixed or common in the group. If it is detrimental to the fitness of an individual, it may be selected against and weeded out of the population entirely. Mutations may cause small changes, or they may cause large changes. One mutation thought to be important in the context of human evolution is ARHGAP11B. All primates possess ARHGAP11A, but a partial duplication of this gene some 5 million years ago resulted in the human-specific ARHGAP11B, a gene that causes brain stem cells to form more stem cells, thus enlarging the neocortex, a portion of the brain vital to cognition. The initial partial duplication likely had little to no impact on the ancient apes that experienced it, but some 1.5 million years ago, a single C-to-G base substitution occurred in the ARHGAP11B gene, leading to the loss of 55 nucleotides from the ARHGAP11B messenger RNA, which caused a shift in the reading frame, resulting in the human-specific functionally critical 47 amino acid sequence that triggers those extra brain stem cells. Point mutations are not rare, but in the case of ARHGAP11B, its advantages of forming a bigger brain likely immediately influenced human evolution. Increased cognition would be subject to the second mechanism of evolution, natural selection, in that it would potentially benefit fitness and be selected for. Fascinatingly, ARHGAP11B works the same way in other primates. Scientists inserted the human-specific gene into fetal marmosets, a small New World monkey, and saw an enormous increase in the size of their neocortex, as well as the characteristic folding of the surface. And all of this change is derived from two common types of mutation. Modern beneficial mutations exist in our species as well. The LRP5V171 mutation causes increased bone density, leading to stronger bones that break less frequently. The -13910*T mutation, found in many European populations, allows lactase production to continue into adulthood, meaning milk consumption can persist through the individual's entire life, rather than becoming lactose intolerant after weaning. Those with the mutation resulting in the HBC variant of the gene for hemoglobin, common in the African nation Burkina Faso, enjoy a reduction in their risk of developing malaria, 23% reduction in those with one copy and 93% in those with two. The third mechanism of evolution, genetic drift, impacted one of our cousins quite severely. Neanderthals, or Homo neanderthalensis, had lower genetic diversity than even the archaic members of our own species they shared the planet with. This was due to their small population sizes, which were subject to strong genetic drift, meaning weakly deleterious alleles were able to persist in the population as if they were neutral. Essentially, Neanderthals were commonly very inbred as a consequence of their small groups. Gene flow impacted our evolution as well. This mechanism involves the exchange of alleles between two populations, which was demonstrably rife within populations of hominid species we used to roam the earth with. Extensive sequencing of the ancient DNA of archaic humans, Neanderthals, and another species known as Denisovans has revealed that these three species actually interbred. Today, if you have European ancestry, you may have up to 5% Neanderthal DNA, and if you have Southeast Asian ancestry, you may have up to 12% Denisovan DNA. Work with modern molecular clocks additionally suggests that the first species that diverged from the LCA, or lowest common ancestor, of humans and chimpanzees may have interbred as well, potentially for millions of years. Examples of the mechanisms of evolution working in primates, and specifically within our own evolutionary lineage, are too numerous to count, but it should be appreciated that, like the rest of the tree of life, we are shaped by the natural processes within and around us.
Thanks for watching. Subscribe to my channel for more tutorials. Support me on Patreon so I can keep making content. And as always, feel free to email me, ProfessorDaveExplains@gmail.com.